Well, good morning and welcome to worship, everyone. My name is Lauren Helger, and I'm the pastor here at Hubbard United Methodist Church, for those of you who don't know me. And I am here with our tech team today, Jeff and Jake and Bill and Rod. And we also have our pianist today, Terry, who is over here. You can't see her. And also with us today is our liturgist, and it is Sherilyn Sinner today. And on behalf of all of us here, we would just like to extend this moment to wish you everyone a very warm welcome, and who is joining us online today. You know, this morning I encourage you to have your Bibles with you as we take a look at Psalm 62 during our message. You know, we are living through a period unlike any other in our nation's history. We mourn the loss today of more than 400,000 of our brothers and sisters as a result of the coronavirus, a number that's expected to increase by another 100,000 in the coming weeks. And there is a vaccine, but for some of us, it may be months before we ever receive it. And that in itself would be enough for our nation to be facing, but it has led to economic distress for many, even members of our own Hubbard Church. And to this, add to this the political unrest and the racial unrest and all of the other issues that have touched your lives over this last year. If ever there was a time when the people of our nation needed prayer and witness to the power of faith, it is now. You know, friends, I know you to be both a people of prayer and a people of faith. And I join with you in praying for all persons in leadership, whether it be at the national level, the corporate level, our schools, our local businesses, our medical centers, and yes, even our church. You know, the future is not always clear, but the way through the present and into a better future is marked by the kinds of messages that we have been hearing from Scripture over the past year in worship. And you see, every one of us has leadership potential and the ability and the opportunity to be a people of influence. And it is my hope and my prayer that the people around us may be able to join us and say of us, see how they love. You know, over the past week, I have been part of several lengthy conversations about COVID and when it is the right time for us to resume in-person worship. And I've noted in the past that our primary concern is the safety of our people, especially those who are the most vulnerable, which applies to all of us here. You know, I would love nothing more than to just invite you all back into the sanctuary for worship, but to be honest, I don't know if I want to be there. You know, we have all established our own boundaries for what is safe and what risks we will take. I mean, even if we opened our doors on Sunday mornings, you would have a choice whether or not you want to attend. Our greater concern is for our worship leaders and our staff, and yes, even your pastor, who might not have the option of attending. And many of our worship leaders have family members with underlying risks, so this is a very tough call. You know, a few churches have chosen to take that risk. Many of their leaders have contracted COVID, and most of the United Methodist churches continue to worship online only. And our council has met, and we have decided to remain online only through Easter, and to remain closed to small groups at this time, and to continue to monitor the positivity rate in our community over the next couple of months, as well as the vaccination rate, to see where we can safely and when we can safely resume in-person worship. Dr. Michael Osterholm predicts that there will be another wave in the coming months as the new strain of virus spreads, and he also hopes that he is wrong. But thus far, his predictions have been fairly accurate. And in the meantime, I am hugely, hugely grateful to all who make our online worship possible and all of you who participate and add your prayers. Will you please join me now as we begin our worship this morning with this video?
and only. So many songs have utilized this phrase to express devoted love. In this week's psalm, we see that this tradition goes back all the way to the poets of the psalm tradition. This is a love psalm of trust in the Holy One and Only, who is the rock and refuge in the midst of life that sometimes feels as fleeting as breath. We put our trust in the one who indeed is holding our lives.
Please pray with me. God of our devotion, you are the one constant in life. Open us this day to see the things that hold us in the grip so that we might shed unnecessary distractions that keep us from seeing your reign on earth as it is in heaven. We praise you for being our rock, holding our lives together in the ways that matter most. Amen. Please join me as we sing our opening hymn this morning. Oh, a mighty fortress is our God.
Psalm 62, Luke and Psalter Translation. In God alone my soul finds rest, for my deliverance comes from God, who alone is my rock, my salvation, my fortress. I will never be shaken. Only in God, my deliverance, my glory, my refuge is God. Trust in God always, my people. Pour out your hearts before God, our refuge. Humankind is but a breath. Mortals are just an illusion. Put them on the scales and the balance is thrown off. They weigh less than a breath. Do not trust in extortion or put false hopes in stolen goods. Do not set your heart on riches, even when they increase. For God has said only one thing, twice have I heard it, that power belongs to God. Steadfast love is yours, Adonai. You repay all people according to their deeds.
God alone is my soul at rest. Be at rest, my soul. In God alone is my soul at rest. Be at rest, my soul. My soul at rest. In God at rest. My soul at rest. In God at rest. Rest my soul at rest. In God at rest. Rest my soul at rest. In God at rest. Rest my soul at rest. In God at rest. Rest my soul.
Well, as I said at the beginning of worship, if there was ever a time to question where we place our security, our hope, and our trust, then surely as we look back over 2020 and into the early part of this year, this is it. But though the events of the past year have brought about widespread challenges, I mean, isn't it true that every year brings about its own challenges? I mean, for you, maybe 2020 wasn't as hard as 2019, depending on how that year went for you. I mean, for me, some of the toughest years on record were 2005 through 2010. And when I was going through cancer treatments and physical and emotional abuse and a divorce, as well as not losing only my job, but also my home. I mean, it was a series of events that will forever be embedded in my mind. And so in that sense, and given the reality of the world that we live in, and how quickly things can change at any given time, you know, the loss of good health, or the loss of employment, or the loss of family members, the incomplete undoing of our plans, you see, given the rest of the reality of this world, that question of where you place your trust and your hope and your security is always a very important question. And this really is what the psalm forces us to ask ourselves. You know, Psalm 62 puts forward two options, God and humanity. And it unashamedly declares that given what God is like and given what humanity is like, rest in God alone. Trust in God alone. And my hope is that this psalm might be a blessing to us in resetting, particularly in given what this year has been like. You know, when I preached back, I remember preaching back at the beginning of COVID, I remember encouraging the slowdown that COVID-19 has forced upon us to revisit our business and our lives, and maybe not in those exact words, but to revisit our priorities, to make sure that we're living for God's kingdom and not for our own earthly kingdom. And now, as the vaccines are rolling out and we begin to emerge from COVID just a little bit, and as things hopefully become a little bit healthier economically, and as a new government has emerged, wouldn't it be for us a great shame to forget the challenges that this past year has brought? I mean, wouldn't it be a shame to forget so quickly how all our earthly plans and securities can be undone? You see, there's a blessing in seeing how ultimately untrustworthy the things of the world truly are and how powerless we are in this world. Because it's when we are reminded of such things that we are reminded of how powerful God really is and how trustworthy God remains. So that's what I'd like you to see in this psalm today. The psalm that David sang is a song about God, in which he describes God's power, God's person, and God's presence, and how David rested in that presence. And this psalm was written in a time when there was a lot going on for David in his world. I mean, he had just recently lost a son. His enemies were advancing on him, and he was struggling personally, and his anxiety level was high. And the question he faced was, what do I do when I am being crushed against the rocks? And similarly, what do we do when we are being crushed against the rocks? Where do we turn? Where do we look for our refuge and our strength? And so I want us to travel through this psalm in a way that King David has written it for us. And I don't want to pick up on the themes and kind of jump all over the psalm. I want us to do the back and forth that David does as he wrote this psalm. Because if you just have a quick look at this psalm, you might want to have it in front of you, I'm just saying. Just notice as we go through this psalm and notice how the psalm moves back and forth between God and humanity. And God and humanity. So let's take a look at verses 1 and 2. They're all about God. And verses 3 and 4 are all about humanity. And 5 through 8 are all about God. And 9 and 10 then are all about humanity. And what David does is he concludes finally with God in verses 11 and 12. So that's what we're going to do when we look at this psalm going from God to humanity. So that we see as we get to the end of this psalm that we really must rest in God. David declares, I am at rest in God alone. My salvation comes from him. He alone is my rock and my salvation, my stronghold. I will never be shaken. Well, you know, it's always difficult to know what the Psalms mean or what David means here when he talks about salvation. I mean, often in the Psalms, particularly in David's Psalms, salvation can be from enemies. Salvation can be from armies. It can be from various traitors within Israel. But he can also talk about salvation from his own sin, like in Psalm 51. Or he can talk about being delivered from Sheol, the place of the realm of the dead. So it's hard to tell exactly what he might be meaning by salvation. But regardless, I think here it's broad. I think when he talks about salvation, it's less about what salvation is from and more about where salvation comes from. And David here is pointing us to the truth that salvation comes from God. God alone, David describes, is the rock. God alone is the stronghold. Imagine it like this. I mean, I'm not sure how many of you have been to Canal Park in Duluth. I mean, I used to sit and watch the ships come in or walk out to the pier, and I used to live in Duluth, so I did this a lot. It's a beautiful place to go exploring, And with Lake Superior just there, like the ocean open in front of you, just next to you. You know, but if you have ever been there on a day when the storms rolled in and the waves came crashing down upon the rocks, I have to say, it is a fierce force to watch. I mean, I remember sitting quite a way back, of course, and watching these big swirls of waves come smashing up against the pier and the rocks. And as I sat there watching, hour upon hour sometimes, I'm at rest. And I am safe, and I will never be shaken, because the place where I am is a stronghold, even though all around me is watery chaos. And it's like that for David as he describes his rest in God. You see, come what may, come enemies or armies or come traitors, come even the grave errors of his own sin, God is his rock. God is his stronghold. God is his salvation. Wherever his salvation comes from, it is from God. But the next section of the psalm is almost the exact opposite, as David moves then into humanity. Because humankind doesn't bring salvation, but instead threat. David says in verse 3, "How long will you threaten a man? Will all of you attack as if he were leaning on a wall or tottering stone fence? They only plan to bring him down from his high position. They take pleasure in lying. They bless with their mouths, but they inwardly curse." And again, it's difficult to know if David has specific people in mind here. I mean, who are the you of verse 3? Who are the they of verse 4? But like salvation, I suspect that David is being quite general in these verses. I don't think he has specific people or a specific enemy in mind. And we need to remember that the Psalms are also poetic. They are often descriptive. They are often declaring general truth rather than concrete events and specific people. And so if the general attributes of God and God is as rock and God is stronghold and the one from whom salvation comes, well, then there are attributes of humanity. And what are those? I mean, humankind threats humankind. Verse 3 tells us that. Humankind will literally kick you when you are down. And that's the picture of the second half of verse 3. I mean, it could be that the psalmist describes himself as the leaning wall or the tottering fence, and attacking him is as easy as just pushing him over with your fingers to knock him down. Or it could be that David is describing a weak city with a poor defense wall that's easy for the taking, so it can easily be attacked. Either way, it is to attack someone while they're defenseless. It's to threaten or attack while the taking is easy. And if God's plans are for salvation, if that's what God is like, well, then humanity's plan is to bring down in verse 4. It's to speak lies and to take down. It's speaking deceptive words of blessing, while inwardly the words are designed to curse. And while this picture might seem overly pessimistic of our humanity in general, don't we see this in our world over and over again? I mean, how many of you have seen the Steve Jobs movie and then also watched the Social Network movie about Mark Zuckerberg? I mean, it's incredible to see that when there's money involved and when there's fame to be won, how quickly friends and business partners become enemies. I mean, how quickly, if the opportunity was there for the taking, that one would speak deceptively against one another. I mean, that one would take another one down, even though once they were friends and sometimes family members. You know, but that is often what our world is like, isn't it? I mean, if the opportunity is there for the taking, there is no doubt that plans would be there in the making, especially in the divisiveness that's going on in our nation right now. You know, the work colleague, perhaps, who says nice things to your face. But when that promotion comes up, you know, or when the next opportunity is up for grabs, well, out comes the quiet word of the boss of, you know, you're a nice person and all, but you're really not the best person for that job or for that promotion. You know, maybe I should be the right one for that job or promotion. Or what about the friend, the one who was our treasured friend before COVID or the election process began, but now that friend has shunned you or defriended you on Facebook and even recruited others to take their side? Or maybe in our own sinful way, we've done that to other people. I mean, you see, salvation comes from God, but from humanity, threats and attack, lying words intended to curse. And so David, the psalmist, comes back again to God in verse 5. And I just noticed that from this psalm that there are a lot of words that are a repeat of verses 1 and 2, which often points to the differences of what we really must know. So verse 5, David writes, "Rest in God alone, my soul. For, I mean, not my salvation this time, but for my hope comes from him. He alone is my rock and my salvation, my stronghold. I will not be shaken. My salvation and glory depend on God, my strong rock. My refuge is in God." And then just notice how David addresses not himself now or his soul, but the people in verse 8. David declares, "Trust in him at all times. You people, pour out your hearts before him. God is our refuge." And so as David then comes back to God, God is his source of hope. God is his source of refuge. And if you remember what David's life was like over and over again, you can see why the hope that he has, he put in humanity, it ultimately failed. And King David, before he was king, he was loyal to King Saul. And that was of no value whatsoever, because when Saul became king, he was jealous of David. And you might remember that David used to live in King Saul's palace for a while, and King Saul's palace was far from a place of refuge for David. In fact, it was quite the opposite. So a number of times, King Saul tried to kill David inside the palace. And he tried to throw spears at him, if you remember. Or you can think of David's advisor, Ahithophel, who betrayed King David to support none other than David's own son, Absalom, when Absalom wanted to become king in place of his father. And so no doubt David knew where true hope comes from. It comes from God. And he knows what happened when he tried to put his hope in humanity. And remember, when the Bible uses the word hope, it's not the kind of wishful hope. It's not the kind of hope that says, "I hope it's going to warm up today or this week." No, it's sure and certain hope. And so knowing what he knows about God and what he knows about humanity, David says to himself in verse 5, "Rest alone in God, my soul. Rest alone in God, my soul." But then look again how he encourages the hearers of this psalm, us, really, in verse 8. He encourages us as hearers to trust in God at all times. Pour out our hearts before him. God is our refuge. And as I read through this again, I can't help, honestly, but think of Paul's words in Philippians 4, because this is the great hope that we have in Christ. This is the peace that comes in finding our refuge in God. And let me just share with you these words. Philippians 4, beginning with verse 4, it says this: "Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Let your graciousness be known to everyone. The Lord is near. Don't worry about anything, but in everything, through prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses every thought, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. You see, for those of us who belong to Jesus, we can pour out our hearts before him. We can bring through prayer and petition all of our requests to God in Jesus. And as we do, we find hope. We find refuge and that peace that surpasses every thought. And just given all that has been going on during this past year, all the fears that have been raised in people's thoughts and minds, you know, fear over their health and worries over finances and anxieties over this unfolding drama of politics and protest. And as Christians, we then have this healthy robustness when it comes to the worries of the world. And as Christians, we have a healthy confidence in Jesus when it comes to the watery chaos around us all over the world. You know, I have Philippians 4 at the end of my prayer list this month, and every time I pray and every time I spend time in prayer in the morning, I then pray, and may the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, guard my heart and my mind in Christ Jesus. And I don't know if this has been your experience, and I hope that it is, because when I pour my heart out before God, to use the words of the psalm, I do rest in God. I do trust in God. I do have that sense of peace that comes, not because life suddenly becomes easier or all my difficulties and my anxieties suddenly disappear, but because we know that no matter what might come our way, God's got this. I mean, God's in it, in the middle of our situation, and God wants what's best for us. And so we rest in that. We rest in God. And as David in the psalm moves back to humanity then in verse 9, he knows that humanity can never ultimately bring hope and refuge. So verse 9, let's have a look. David says this, "Men are only a vapor, exalted men, an illusion. Weighed in the scales, they go up. Together, they are less than a vapor. Place no trust in oppression or false hope in robbery. If wealth increases, pay no attention to it." And now, as you reflect on these words, it's pretty easy to see how true this is. I mean, people, folks, are just like a mist, a vapor, here today and gone tomorrow. And more than that, humanity is always under the sovereign rule of God. Humanity can think so highly of itself and place so much comfort in and of itself, and yet if you balance humanity on the scales, if you place all of humanity on the scales, you can see that the scales go up because humanity is not as weighty as it thinks. Humanity is not as substantial as it thinks. You know, there's a Colin Buchanan song that picks up this idea. And Colin, maybe you've heard of him. He's usually known for his kids' songs, but he's also a fairly successful country singer. And typically, I don't listen to country music. It's not my favorite. But Colin has this lovely album called Calvary Road. And one of the songs on this album is called Will I Be Missed? And Colin uses Steve Jobs, you know, the Apple man, as a bit of an example. And he says this, "The man who invented the iPhone couldn't wait to see what he'd do next. With his little round glasses and joggers and jeans and his black turtleneck, he was a visionary, a genius, an icon. All the magical gadgets he made, he put a ding in the universe, and then he lay down in the grave." And the chorus goes like this. He sings, "Will I be missed? What will they say? Just a few that will notice that I've gone away. The sorrow goes by, the tears will be gone. No one gets missed for long." And then Colin goes on to finish, "I'm just a mist blowing away, born in the morning, live for a day." You see, humanity ultimately is only a mist. It's a vapor. And the greatest among us, like Steve Jobs, might seem on top of the world, but it's just an illusion, says the psalm. You see, death overtook him early in his life, relatively, and death will overtake us all. And even the wealth, as it says in verse 10, is no hope or refuge. Pay no attention to it, because often it's won through oppression and robbery, even if we don't realize it. And so, one last time, David returns and concludes with what God is like. So let's look at verses 11 and 12. And now David says in verse 11, God has spoken once. I have heard this twice. Strength belongs to God. And faithful love belongs to you, Lord, for you repay each according to his works. And this is what we are invited to remember as we come to the end of this psalm. You see, why can we rest in God alone when it comes to our salvation? Why can we rest in God alone when it comes to our hope and our refuge? Well, it's because God is all-powerful and God is faithful. And David learned this early on. I mean, why did David, as a young, scrawny youth, dare to take on the giant Goliath? I mean, when all the rest of Israel were terrified and scared, David took him on because, humanly speaking, they should have been scared. And the Philistines were a greater army, and they had this giant. And why was David willing to fight that? Was it because of his power? Was it because of his strength? No. It was because of God. And not only because of God's power and God's strength, but it was because David knew that God is faithful to God's people. David knew that God would deliver on this promise to save his people. And you might not remember this, but in 1 Samuel 17, when David was there before the Philistine army, just before he killed Goliath, he said this, and he said this to the Philistine. Samuel 17, 45 through 47 says this. You come against me with a dagger, a spear, and a sword, but I come against you in the name of Yahweh of hosts, the God of Israel's armies. You have defied him. Today the Lord will hand you over to me. Then all will know that Israel has a God. And this whole assembly will know that it is not by sword or by spear that the Lord saves, for the battle is the Lord's. He will hand you over to us. So you understand how David can say that my salvation and my hope comes from the Lord. And don't we see this most fully in the life and death and resurrection of our Lord Jesus? You know, see, you friends, this psalm gives us the opportunity to reset. There is a blessing in resetting, of being reminded throughout this past year, ultimately, we are not in control. And the things of this world are like a mist and a vapor and illusionary. They can disappear so quickly in the great scheme of things. And so what are we to do? Rest in God alone. Trust in God alone. Rejoice in the Lord always. I say it again, rejoice. As we get to the end of this psalm, there are two options before us, God and humanity. And so which one, friends, will you put your trust in? Where will you go to look for your hope and salvation? Because if we trust in ourselves, or if we trust in humankind as a whole, we know from this psalm that salvation and hope will never come from humanity. But if we look to the God who is powerful, and we look to the God who is faithful to save in Jesus, we can rest in God. We can find true hope and true salvation. So let me just finish again with verse 8. David, our Lord, says this to us. Trust in God at all times, you people. Pour out your hearts before him. God is our refuge. Amen.
Let us now center our hearts. We will hear the sound of the singing bowl and then have some silence. Feel free to close your eyes if you like. Imagine yourself held in safety and love and care. When you hear the residents again, open your eyes. Let us take a moment to write prayer concerns on small pieces of paper. Then place your prayers into a container, a bowl, a box, whatever you might have on hand, as a symbolic action of placing them in God's hands, God's care. Let the people say, Selah.
Selah.
Let us continue our prayers. I will offer a category of concern, and we will allow a brief pause. Then we will respond as indicated. As a prayer posture for this worship series, I invite you to cup your hands, ready to receive God's love and peace, and in preparation to be God's love and peace in the world. Let us pray for the leaders of this world and this church community and for the healing of this nation. God of justice, hear our prayer. Let us pray for those who live in conflict around the world. Prince of peace, hear our prayer. Let us pray for all who are experiencing loss of any kind in this pandemic. Comforting healer, hear our prayer. Let us pray for those who are homeless, hungry, and alone. Emmanuel, God with us, hear our prayer. Let us pray for those who live in comfort, for Christ-like hospitality and generosity. Transforming spirit, hear our prayer. Holy and living one, for those we have named and the ones whose names we do not know. Hear our prayer. Let us pray together as Jesus taught us the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Christ be with you, and also with you. Will you please make a gesture of extending your cupped hands towards others who may be with you as a sign of offering the peace that Christ gives us? If you are alone, just place your hands, your cupped hands, over your heart as a sign that you send your heartfelt peace out.
So strong you tender hands held out and trust and blessing where words fall short, let hands speak out the hearts of love express.
We belong together in this house through the love that God draws us together. We also know that God's love extends to this community and to the world around us. You know, this morning, as we come to our time of offering, I just invite you to give generously, trusting that your gifts will be multiplied in so many ways. Now, here at Hubbard, there are several ways that you can do that, and you can follow the instructions you see here on the screen, and you can call the church office, and I don't have the phone number up here today, but I'll try and have that up here next week, and we, just know that we will continue to be thoughtful stewards of each and every gift given. So thank you for your thoughtful and generous contributions. Now, as we conclude today, I just want to thank you again for joining us in worship. We're so grateful that you made this choice to be with us because we know that there are many other opportunities and places you could be and spend your time. And I just look forward to seeing everybody on Zoom because our fellowship time is such a wonderful way for us to just connect. And also, next week, we're going to be spending time in Psalm 111, so I hope to see you back then as well. You know, before Terry leads us in our final hymn this morning, I would just like to send you with these, this charge and benediction that we have been hearing throughout this series and has become very familiar. Go forth this day in the knowledge that God is holding your life even as we hold each other. You are not alone. You are loved. Go in peace. Amen.
Thank you.
we will sit, come, Spirit.